Suppose you're at the grocery store doing some shopping. You're hoping to pick up 300 pineapples with your friend Catherine, who's looking for 200 mangoes. Luckily, your other friend Melissa already has 75 kiwis at home. But you can't buy anything until you've figured out how much 103 pineapples, 56 and 3/16 mangoes, and 27 kiwis cost. Well, this is how I always shop. Today, we're going to talk about word problems. Math problems described by a short story or scenario you have to translate back into math in order to solve. Not everyone finds them terrible, but if you've had trouble with them in the past, you may find that you look at one and just shut down. So let's talk about why that is and how to get past it. G'day, I'm James Tanton, and this is Study Hall Algebra, presented by Arizona State University and Crash Course. First, you might be confused because many word problems you find in textbooks just sound ridiculously artificial. I mean, why do you need 300 pineapples? And why are you wondering how much they cost? We're at a store where things have price tags, for heaven's sakes. None of this would actually ever happen in real life. So they can feel hokey, or worse, like they're made up just to trick us. And I don't know about you, but if I feel like I'm being set up, I start feeling resentful and suspicious, and that can make it hard to think clearly. But life does have problems. The more ambitious the problem, like in engineering or medicine or history, the more likely it will contain numbers or patterns that relate to each other in complex ways. We do use words to make sense of these problems, and ultimately to solve them. Now, when solving problems, be they in algebra or the rest of life, there are two key steps that no one seems to talk about, and that ends now. But I just need an example. Now, if I quickly consult my little book of word problems, let's see. 1 gallon of 50% salt solution is mixed with 3 gallons of 10% salt solution. What is the concentration of salt in the resulting 4 gallons? As you might be able to see, I'm a little flustered, but I'm going to acknowledge my emotional reaction because how I'm feeling influences my problem solving. And that's the first step, be human. I'm feeling a little alarmed and unprepared. Now, I was talking quite confidently about word problems in general, but now that I have a specific example, I'm just a bundle of nerves. And that's okay. Mathematics is a human experience, not just computations. If you're nervous about a problem, you might skip over important information when you read it. If you're excited or worried about something in another part of your life, you might feel like algebra is totally irrelevant and find it hard to focus. And if you feel like you finally get the type of problem you're working on, you might feel confident enough to read ahead to the next topic so you keep that good feeling going. You don't have to fake enthusiasm. You just have to bring yourself, however you're feeling. So acknowledge your reaction to the problem and then take a deep breath. And then step two is do something, anything. Read the question again, read the question backwards. Maybe write down all the numbers you see in it. Just do something, whether it's related to the problem or not. Now, it sounds like we're procrastinating, but we waste a lot more time by just sitting there doing nothing, staring hopelessly at the problem. Doing something helps overcome the emotional hurdle of getting started, hopefully leading to some progress. All right, so I've acknowledged my reaction here, nervousness. Now it's time to do something. I'm going to try drawing a picture to see if that can help me set up the problem. So let's go piece by piece and see what the problem gives us. 1 gallon of 50% salt solution. Okay, that sounds drawable. It doesn't have to be fancy. In fact, the simpler the better. So this gallon is just a block of liquid, and I know that half, 50% of it, is salt. That helps me see how I could start writing a math expression. We need to think about the amount of salt. Let's call it S. So far we have S equals 1 times 0.5. Half that 1 gallon is salt. Now, our first gallon is mixed with 3 more gallons of 10% salt. So that's 3 more blocks of liquid, and a tenth of each is salt. Since we know we're combining liquids, we can go ahead and divide the first block into tenths to match the other gallon blocks. So that's going to add more salt to S, giving me the equation S equals 1 times 0.5 plus 3 times 0.1. If we work that out, S equals 0.8. Is that the answer? 0.8 seems like a lot of salt per gallon. It's almost too much. All right, let's reread the question and focus on what kind of answer we need to give. 1 gallon of 50% salt solution is mixed with 3 gallons of 10% salt solution. What is the concentration of salt in the resulting 4 gallons? I already have 4 total gallons in this drawing, so I don't actually need to draw anything else. I just need to figure out how much of the 4 gallons is salt. So 0.8 gallons is the amount of the 4 gallons that it's salt. Aha. Now that seems more reasonable. To match how the problem was written, we could translate to a percentage. 0.8 over 4 equals 0.2. 20% salt seems like a logical amount for a 50% solution diluted with a lot of 10% solution. And we can check our work with our picture. I have 5 blocks of salt in the first gallon, 1 in the second, 1 in the third, and 1 in the fourth. That's 8 blocks of salt out of a total of 40 blocks. And 8 out of 40 is equal to 2 out of 10, or 1 out of 5, 20%. My equations are confirming what my drawing is already telling me. Okay, let's try another one. The only way to get better at word problems is to practice. A farmer has 200 meters of fencing and needs to build a pen for their goat, which keeps wandering off and eating their neighbor's laundry. One side of the rectangular pen will consist of the wall of the orchard, which is 80 meters long. The goat is 1 meter long from nose to tail. What is the area of the finished pen? Does that make for a small goat? And how much laundry could a goat possibly eat? I wish I had a pet goat. All right, so what's my emotional reaction here? Clearly I'm daydreaming. My mind is wandering. If I acknowledge that, I can redirect and focus. I'm going to do something different than last time and start by making a list of the numbers we have and the numbers we want. The numbers we have are 200 meters of fencing, 80 meters of wall, and 1 meter of goat. Actually, do we need that last one? Nope. No one's ever told me to find the length of a goat before calculating the area of a rectangle. So sometimes word problems can come with extra information that won't help us solve the problem. And the numbers we want are, oh, just one number, the area of the pen. It's a rectangular pen, so we just need length and width. Our first list shows we can call the length 80 meters, so now we just need the width. So how do we find the width? Well, we start with 200 meters of fencing, and we'll use 80 for the side opposite the orchard wall. So we have 200 minus 80, which leaves 120 for the other two sides. And 120 divided by 2 is 60. So let's check if that works. 60 and 60 and 80 equals 200 meters of fencing. Yes, I feel triumphant. But wait, we want the area of the finished pen, not just the side lengths. Sometimes solving a tricky bit in the problem can feel like we've solved the whole thing, but we always have to check what the question was actually asking for. 80 meters times 60 meters is 480 square meters. I solved this problem by gathering my information and asking myself questions about what information I still needed. Now, everyone claims algebra shows up in real life, but sometimes it'll be quite hard to notice. Now, we can put in our math goggles and use our XYZ vision to see better. So you're probably never going to buy 300 pineapples, but you might go to the movies with some friends. At the theater, two of your friends picked up sodas and popcorn while the rest of you nabbed some good seats. One friend got 3 popcorns and 2 sodas and paid $23.75. Your other friend got 2 popcorns and 1 soda for $14.75. On the way home, you're trying to figure out how much you owe them for your soda. But the movie theater didn't itemize the receipts. You know you all had the same sizes of the sodas and popcorns, so it should be possible to figure out what each item costs. Equations with X's and Y's seem like overkill, but maybe you can just visualize the situation. Good thing you have your math goggles on. So you start drawing on the back of the receipt. 3 popcorns and 2 sodas equals $23.75, while 2 popcorns and 1 soda equals $14.75. If you had 5,000 sodas and 3,000 popcorns, you wouldn't be able to draw a picture on one side. But because you have such small quantities, a quick sketch can help you notice patterns. And you do. In both equations, you have 1 soda and 2 popcorns. And you know that equals $14.75. Subtract the first equation from the second, and you get a new equation. 1 popcorn and 1 soda equal to 9. Adding that to your list of original equations helps you notice something else. 1 soda and 1 popcorn shows up in the second equation. So you can subtract your new equation from that one and see 1 popcorn equals $5.75. So close. We could plug that into any of our equations, but the third equation seems easiest. Aha, 1 soda equals $3.25. You've just solved this algebra problem without any X's or Y's at all. Solving problems visually might seem like a weird thing to do in an algebra class, but in fact, noticing patterns and experimenting with them is the essence of mathematics. So when faced with a word problem, whether in a textbook or on the street, what can you do? Draw a picture to help set up your equations. And sometimes drawing a picture will solve your equation. And if you're working on a problem where it initially seems like you need lots and lots of variables, see if you can describe everything based on just one variable. For example, let's say you have a problem involving Alice, Bennett, and Carl's ages. Instead of signing A, B, and C, see if you can describe them in terms of A, A plus 2, and 2A minus 7. You just have one unknown to solve for instead of 3. Next time, we'll look at other confusing areas of math people rarely explain, including negative numbers and some ideas about why they behave the way they do. Until then, cheers! Thanks for watching Study Hall Algebra, which is produced by Arizona State University and the Crash Course team at Complexly. If you like this video and want to keep learning with us here at Study Hall, be sure to subscribe. You can learn more about ASU and the videos produced by Crash Course and the links in the description. See you next time.